tell me a little bit about how somebody taking fighting rifle, how those skills can translate to somebody not in law enforcement or military.
Well, we only, for self-defense, we only take handguns to fights that we don't know we're going to get into. We take long guns to fights we know we're going to get into. And so anybody that uses a rifle for any defensive use, a fighting rifle is a good class for them. And what we say is, as far as these classes, like fighting pistol, fighting rifle, shotgun, they are vocationally generic. Doesn't matter what you do for a living, soccer mom or a cop or soldier or whatever, it's running the rifle, the mindset that goes along with it, and the tactics.
James, I just took the first day of the two-day immediate action medical class. Is that more important, equally important to the firearms training?
Well, I believe if we look at it from a warrior's perspective, we should dedicate as much time learning to heal as we do to kill. And I believe that every warrior should have two trauma kits, one for inducing and one for relieving, and know how to use them both proficiently, the same level of expertise.
I've taken fighting pistol, fighting rifle, immediate action medical. I'll finish up tomorrow. Is that the right order? Or
yeah, I don't care.
Okay, and then we've also got the fight.
Uh-huh.
And you know, you offer the force on force training. Is that, would that be kind of the next logical step?
When people, I call it the tactical response holy trinity, the trifecta, the tactical response trifecta: fighting pistol, immediate action medical, and the fight. Really, in any order you want to take them, it doesn't really matter. But those are the three classes that I don't care if you're a cop, soldier, citizen. I don't care if you're a soccer mom. I don't care. Those are the three classes that I think everybody should take from tactical response.
And the advantage to a lot of those classes, especially in the current climate we're in right now, is that you don't need ammo for
the force on force.
Or
the medical, or the armorers classes, or the bug out class.
Right. And extremely useful skills. That what I even learned today in my first day of medical classes ever, I'm so super excited about, because it's like you said, those skills you can take anywhere, you know? You train
medical skills.
Medical skills you can take anywhere. Training with a firearm is great, but you're limited. You said, you know, I've never been stopped from taking a tourniquet on a plane.
Ever.
Right. And not only that, we've learned that you don't even have to have your tourniquet. You just use whatever's available.
Right.
Now that I have those skills, it's a little bit like I don't just know how to drive the car. I know how to drive the car and change the tire if I have to.
Right. And I mean, look at like at Virginia Tech, the first one, a scout that was going to school there made a tourniquet with a lamp cord and saved his own life. You know, you can take that anywhere. And it doesn't matter what you do for a living. It doesn't matter if you even own a gun. Medical skills are good to have. And this is what people need to understand. This is not a Red Cross first aid class. We're doing real stuff here. We get the highest compliments from immediate action medical, from paramedics and emergency docs that come and take the class. Yes, emergency docs and paramedics. But we get the highest compliments from them. Like paramedics say, this is all the best stuff out of paramedic school in 2 days. ER docs go, this is great stuff. You know, I wish more people knew this, because more people could get people alive to my ER for me to actually work on. So we get the highest compliments from the people that know better.
Awesome. James, anything else you want to say about tactical response? I know you've got some big names passing through pretty soon and a lot of exciting things going on.
I mean, we host classes. We host guys like John Farnham every January. And John, you know, you got to train with John Farnham. We're hosting Tom Givens this year. We're hosting, we already hosted Rob Pincus. I mean, and we teach classes too. Something for everybody. You know, we got AR-15 armors classes. We got AK armors classes, you know, from Rifle Dynamics is coming out to teach those. So we got stuff going on.
How come you hire instructors that don't have anything in common with each other or with you?
Oh, for tactical
I mean, not in common. You guys all have most things in common, but your personalities are all vastly different.
You don't mean the guys are host.
No,
the guys are employees.
I mean, tactical response employees, how come their personalities are so varied?
Because you can't make a good pizza with just pepperoni. And it's the ingredients. And so I hire guys that are good at this and guys that are good at that and this personality and that personality. And so it's like no two of us are the same person. Although Scott is trying to clone Jay, I think, or something. I don't know what's going on there. It's kind of weird. I don't know. But it just works. I hire guys that, and the key thing for everybody is passion. Everybody that works here is passionate about it. And sometimes that is viewed by the students as the instructors being angry. We're not angry. We just know that this matters. And we've had students come and just take a two-day class and then go and get in a gunfight. And so it kind of puts a lot of pressure on us. Like, I got 2 days to make sure you do this right.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're passionate about it. And sometimes that comes across to people that are a little bit more mild or meek. It comes across as like anger or somebody being an asshole. It's not. When we say, move, it's because we don't want you to get shot. We say, reload your guns, because we don't want you to get shot, you know.
When we were in the middle of doing team-based rifle drills with a partner, they explained the drill, and I was trying to memorize exactly what to do. Okay, I'm going to fire.
Shoot, move, communicate.
Yeah, I'm going to fire. I'm going to fire rounds at this piece of cardboard, and then I'm going to move around in this barrel, and then I'm going to do this. And the first time I did that, it didn't go very well. But Jay and Scott were yelling at me things like, "Your buddy's getting shot. You need to be," and saying things that took it from like a piece of cardboard and barrel to actual cover that you would use and a bad guy shooting at you. And it was like I was then trying less to memorize what to do. And if you actually listen to what they're trying to tell you, like if it's a real life scenario, it made a lot more sense.
Well, the thing is, like we say at the beginning of class, we want you to visualize it, to make it real in your mind. And so when we give that command to start the drill, we really want people to think they're in a gunfight and act like they're in a gunfight and have that same sense of urgency and that same level of tenacity. But some guys just kind of go through the motions or whatever, but we want that. And sometimes we inject that in there, you know, hurry up, somebody's dying, or you got to do this, you got to do that, just to create this more tense situation. And it works.
So you've got teenagers, you've got people as old as, how old?
Are students?
Yeah.
My oldest student so far has been 89.
Okay. So even in my class alone, there was probably at least a 40-year gap between the youngest and the oldest. Not to mention, everybody's going to be learning at slightly different levels. So how do you as instructors at Tactical Response kind of deal with that?
We treat everybody like they are motivated and intelligent. That's
okay.
It. And it's not very often. I mean, it's very rare. But if you can't keep up, we don't slow the class down for you. We ask you to leave.
What I noticed is that even in a class of 15 people, let's say you're in a class of 15 people, and you're working on something like trigger reset, and you think like, well, I can maybe not be doing the proper trigger reset every time and kind of get away with it. No, if somebody wasn't doing it right, it'd be like, even if everybody else was done, that, you know, you just make sure, no, you know, okay, this guy, I'm going to work with this guy to make sure he gets it right.
Well, the thing with us, like there are instructors that'll do a class, and they'll literally have 30 or 40 people in the class, and there's only one guy there. That's unsafe, and it's not a good learning environment. I'm not going to name anybody, but you can find these people. It's not hard. Our instructor ratio is 6 or 7 to 1. We never let it get past 7 to 1. So if there's 8 people in a class, there's 2 instructors there in the story. And we really want to give everybody that individual attention. And see, there are things that we do that you may never have noticed from your side of the firing line. But behind the firing line, we got one guy that runs the line, and we got the other guys that work the line. Well, every once in a while, every time we take a break to load mags, those guys switch sides or switch positions, because every instructor's got these things he looks for, and we want to spread that around. We want the instructor that worries 1,000% about grip, we don't want him to stay the same 6 people. Okay, we want him to go down to help the other people where the reloading guy was and help them. So we want to spread that around. And each instructor has his own perspectives, his own way to explain things. And so if we have a problem student, I can switch instructors, and all of a sudden the problem student goes away, because this instructor can articulate it in a way that guy can understand, and it helps. So that's, you know, that's important to us. The educational process is very important to us.
Your responsibility to be ready for the fight
never ends.
Thanks.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.